everybody. Look at your neighbor. Say, you ready? You ready? Poke them. If they're not ready, if they're not responding, poke them. Hey, I remember when my kids were first born, and how many people ever had like a preschooler in your house? Raise your hands. It's exhausting, isn't it? You're like, I made you, and I could kill you because I can make another one to replace you, right? But I remember talking. Just kidding. Just kidding. Don't do that. The government frowns on it. So does God. But I remember asking my mom in that moment, I said, Mom, what was your favorite time, your favorite season of being a parent? Tell me, because you got to tell me it's going to get better than this because I'm exhausted all the time. And she gave me one of the greatest pieces of parenting advice I ever got, which is the season that is my favorite, the season that is the best, is the season I'm in right now. And so if you're a young parent, hang in there. I promise it's going to get different. You want me to say it's going to get better? Will get better, but it will also get worse. But my very favorite season is the season I'm in now, and it's the season of having adult children that can drive their own cars, and more importantly, can pay their own bills. Thank you, Jesus. We made a deal. As long as they want to, they can stay on my cell phone plan, but they pay for their own part. So two of them pay their own way. It's amazing. It's great. And so I'm almost done paying for someone else to have a cell phone, but I've been helping Zach. Remember last week we talked about the fact he just moved out into his own apartment. He's calling us more than he has ever called us in the last 5 years. It is awesome because he's like, how in the world do I cook this or how do I set this up? And we're like, this is awesome. He called me the other day. He's like, can you help me with my retirement account? I'm like, praise God. This is such great news. If at 21 you're already giving money to your retirement account, this is going to be a much better future for you. And then he's like, well, Dad, I got my renter's insurance. I said, well, did you have them transfer your auto insurance? He's like, oh, I need to do that? I was like, well, yes, you do. Let me remind you, he's a 21-year-old male. You know who's the most expensive to insure? The 16-year-old back there. But the 21 is right there, right behind him. I was like, you need to take this. And then he was like, well, Dad, what about my car? I think my transmission is going bad. He said this week. I was like, oh, this is not good. You don't have the money yet to fix a transmission. Do you know what it was? Someone had knocked the four-wheel low. He didn't even notice it, so he couldn't get the car to go more than 20 miles an hour. And all they did at the transmission shop was put it back in two-wheel drive. Praise Jesus. This is awesome. It's working out great for us. But all kinds of advice is going from us to our adult children. It's just fun. Brittany called last night. We were talking about things. I'm just sharing all these life lessons with them. And I thought, what would I do if I could go back 30 years ago, 50 years, 30, 40 years ago? What would I tell younger me? What would be the life lesson that I would want younger me to understand? And I would tell younger me this, whether it was a 6-year-old, 16, 26, 36, 46. Can't get to 56 yet. But you know what I would say? Learn to pray more. Pray more. Spend more time in prayer and less time in worry. Spend more time talking to God instead of waiting until the last minute and thinking, oh, at the very last minute, I'm at my wit's end, I better pray. In fact, the first thing I want you to know today is prayer should not be our last resort, but our first response. When we wake up in the morning and things aren't going well, what should be our first response? It should be prayer. Well, when things are going really well and you're sitting in front of whatever lunch you're about to enjoy after church today, right? Some of you are already checked out from message. You're already into sitting in front of a big plate. Sausage gravy with some homemade biscuits, bacon, and eggs over easy. Pray. When things are great, pray. When things are horrible, pray. When things are stagnant, pray. When things seem not to be going the way we want it to, pray. When things are going the way we want, pray. We all want to pray more. We all know we should pray more. But when we get to the end of the day, I frequently ask myself, why in the world didn't I spend more time in prayer? Right? The disciples, the Jesus' homeboys, the ones he walked with as he lived out life in the New Testament, as Jesus was walking out life, his disciples saw him do crazy stuff. They saw with their own eyes, heard with their own ears. They watched as Jesus did miracles, fed people, turned water into wine, healed people from sickness, gave sight to the blind. He even rose a dude from the dead. They heard him preach the greatest sermon ever, the Sermon on the Mount. Watched him take care of people with empathy that you and I just don't have. But the one thing that we see in Scripture, that they went to Jesus and they said, "We have watched you do all this stuff. The one thing we want to know more about, the one we want to learn about, is how in the world do you pray like that?" I want to be a person of prayer. You can look at Luke chapter 11, verse 1. Now Jesus was praying in a certain place, and when he finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray." You see, the disciples had watched him over and over again pray. They had seen the way physically he prayed. They heard the words that came out of his mouth in prayer. They've watched Jesus pray, and they want to know, what do you know about prayer that we don't know? Because if we know what you know, we'll pray like you pray. The rest of us don't pray like Jesus prayed, because Jesus knew stuff that we don't know. Jesus lived previously in heaven. He sat with the Father. He's the second person of the Trinity. He's God with skin on. Jesus knows stuff about God that we just don't know. But look at the way Jesus chose to live. Luke chapter 5, it puts it this way, "But he," that's Jesus, "would withdraw to desolate places like Texas and pray." I'm just kidding. Sorry, Texas people. Sorry. I'm an equal opportunity offender. I'll get to the people in West Virginia soon. But he would withdraw to desolate places and he would pray. He would willingly go places that were desolate and spend time in prayer. He had a way to pray. Jesus knew the most, that he needed to pray the most. And if you knew what Jesus knew, then you would pray like Jesus prayed. And these are the things Jesus knew. He left heaven and came to earth. Before he even walked on planet earth, he created everything. He has no beginning, no end. And if you could learn what Jesus knew, you would do what Jesus did. So for us, often prayer is too little a thing to give too much time to. It's too small a thing to give too big of time to. But for Jesus, he knew that prayer was too big a thing to give little time to. So what I want to do is I want to dive into prayer over the next couple of weeks. I want prayer to be our first response. I want us to be a group of people that, as people talk about Valley Fellowship Church in Buena Vista, Colorado, what they do is they say, "I don't know much about what they do. I don't know that music. I don't know what they do about teaching, but I know it's a place that prays." Because you can think about it for a moment. Think about people that walk in the Christian label, and they know the Bible from beginning to end, front and back. And they're some of the meanest people that you will ever meet. Think about the people that come into a room and they just worship. They give their hearts to God. They give it all to God. They can be some of the most arrogant people that you will ever meet. But you will never find someone who has devoted their lives to prayer that falls into either of those categories. Prayer has a way of humiliating us if we're not willing to humble ourselves. So we either choose to fall on our face before God in prayer, or life's going to make us grumble, amen. Inserted here. So the disciples, they wanted a deeper relationship. The disciples wanted to draw closer and closer to God. So they say to Jesus, "Teach us to pray." And Jesus gives them what you might know, you might have memorized as the Lord's Prayer. Maybe somebody taught you it's the model prayer. It's part of the greater Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 6. So hopefully you have a handout. All of the verses are going to be in there and on the screens for you. They're also, as we go through it, if you don't own a Bible or the Bible you own is hard to understand, we have free Bibles. They're out at Next Steps. Just say, "Can I get a free Bible?" You don't have to give us anything. We just want you to have a Bible. You can also text the word Bible to 719-223-3996. It'll get you an app that has every version of the Bible known to humanity. We're going to get back to that Bible app here in just a bit. But Matthew chapter 6, beginning in verse 9. Jesus commands them, "Pray then like this." If you want to learn how to pray? Pray then like this. "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." this prayer. We thank you for what you've given us in prayer, that we might learn what it looks like to know what Jesus knew and pray like Jesus prayed. Father, would you in this moment help us all, whether prayer is a struggle or prayer is something that's vibrant in our lives, would you help us all take a next step into a deeper relationship with you through these simple words in this prayer. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray these things. Amen. Amen. So if we knew what Jesus knew, then I bet we would learn to pray like Jesus prayed. And I think just today we're gonna look at the beginning of this model prayer. We're going to look at eight simple words, actually. But as we look at these eight simple words, we're going to see four insights that Jesus knew. I want you to write them down. Even if you're not normally a note taker, this one is helpful, I promise you. The first one I want you to write down is you never outgrow your Heavenly Father. You never outgrow your Heavenly Father. Jesus is teaching us in that prayer. He says those first four words, our Father in, help the boy, heaven. Where does God the Father live? Where does he reside? In heaven. Heaven is not earth. Heaven is not here. You never outgrow God because God's in heaven. You don't rise above God because you'll never get bigger than God here on earth. So what is the difference? What's the challenge then in prayer? Are our prayers sometimes become absent because we don't even know what does it matter if I don't even pray? Why? What does it matter if prayer never becomes part of my life? I want you to know this. When we don't pray, it says as much about our Father in heaven as we do pray. So our prayerlessness reflects where we think God lives. Our prayerlessness reflects that we don't take seriously that our Father is in, help the boy, heaven. He's in heaven. He's greater than us. People say, well, why would I pray? What would happen if I don't pray? And instead of trying to motivate you to pray right now, let me just point out, when we don't pray, it reflects on our view, our theology of who God is. You're saying as much about prayer as you are about God. When you don't pray, you basically are saying to God, I don't need you. I've outgrown you. Now, one of the hard parts about being a dad with adult kids is they've outgrown me. Used to be that my middle son, my middle child, my oldest son, would only call when he needed money. I have three kids, and as they get older, they don't talk to me as much, right? But I want you to know that makes sense. That's the way we raise them. My oldest, Brittany, is 26 years old. She lives in Southern California. When she was six, we hung out all the time. I took her to school. I picked her up from school. We did daddy-daughter dates. We would go before school, after school. I went to every cross-country meet, choir concert. Every single thing that she did in her life, I went to. I was with her all the time. But when she went to college, we started talking less and less. She graduated, moved across to the East Coast, to Baltimore, Maryland. And I barely ever heard her because she was becoming her own person. She had her own career, her own house, her own car. She's an adult. You could say that Brittany has outgrown her earthly father. But I want you to know that's appropriate. And I consider that a huge win. I love the fact that she is flying high. I love listening to her. I love hanging out with her. I love vacationing with her. But it's nothing like it used to be. Because she has outgrown her earthly father. And what Jesus is saying is, your heavenly father is different than your earthly father. Your heavenly father desires, you're created to always be, to never outgrow relationship with him. You are created for God, from God. You're to get your purpose from God, your calling from God. The way we do life is intimately tied into the heavenly father. And it's because he's in heaven and you'll never reach a spot where he's close enough that you can outgrow him. My children will outgrow me because I'm their earthly father, but they will never outgrow their heavenly father because he's in heaven. I would even go so far as to say we need our Father in heaven. Because if our God was so small that we could always just conjure him into some kind of slot machine deity, he would be doing things for us that aren't even good for us. But your heavenly Father sits at 60,000 foot view of your life and sees it all. He knew what happened. He knows what's going to happen. And he's watching it. So when you neglect prayer, you're neglecting the relationship with the heavenly Father. You're neglecting the protection from heaven, the provision from heaven, the wisdom from heaven, the power from heaven. And
That's what Jesus wants you to know. If you knew what Jesus knew, that your Father is in heaven, it would change the way we prayed. Second thing I think Jesus would want you to know is this is a heart-engaged relationship. This is a heart-engaged relationship. Look at what Jesus says. We talked about heaven already, but this one I want to talk about is our Father in heaven. Now, the nation of Israel at this point, the good Jews would know that the nation had a heavenly Father. The nation had a Father. There was a religious, a distanced relationship with God. He was our Father, but he wasn't my Father. But what Jesus wants you to know is this is a heart-engaged relationship. It's not some formula. It's not some religious system. He is your Father. He's actually going to use the word Abba, which is actually a very intimate word, a close word, a word that reflects that he's our daddy. He goes from being the Father of Israel to being my heavenly Father. He's relational, intimate, personal. He's awesome. He's powerful. He's holy. He's mighty. All of that is true. But he's also intimate and relational with us. And this would have been, as Jesus spoke this to them, gave them the model prayer. If you know what Jesus knows, you'll pray like Jesus prays. Your prayer is one-on-one with God. Let me ask you, how do you picture God in prayer? Is he like Gandalf sitting on some throne with his long, flowy beard? He's got his staff with an orb on it, just looking at you with some snarled look? Like, he's holy, he's perfect, he's righteous. So is God, as you pray to him, unapproachable? Or is he the Father that's with you? Is he the one that you could pull up a chair next to you? Could you sit and talk to Abba Father? Can you talk to Heavenly Daddy? Is he fully present? Or is this God the one that's playing some kind of game or going through his email instead of paying attention to you? He's the best. I fail my kids all the time. I get distracted. I'm like, what did you, huh? He's fully present. He's got a heart engaged relationship with you, and he desires the same from you for him. Here's another way I like to picture this. When Jake, my son, was growing up, yes, I owe you a milkshake. I'm cool with that. But when he was growing up, it's a rule with Jake. If I bring him up in a sermon, he gets a milkshake. So, if you guys could give $3 in the offering box, that'll help pay for it. Just kidding. It's a joke. It's just a joke. But when he was a little guy, he had two speeds, right? He had two speeds. He had 100% on, running, like do everything, 100%, or just off and passed out on his bed or the carpet or wherever he stopped. But imagine this, like fully on and then fully off. See, our prayer life can be fully on with God, and then we can turn everything fully off and just be with God. You can imagine your prayer life being like in drive or in park, right? Sometimes in life, it's conversational. It's just driving through. It's a running dialogue with God throughout the days. But then some point in life, you need to put the car in park, pull up the parking brake, shut it all down. You're not going anywhere. You're not doing anything, but you're completely focused on God because you're in park and just meditating on who he is and how great he's been to us. But then there's a conversational one. You put the car in drive. And I'm just constantly talking to God. I'm constantly in a conversation with God. Like when I wake up in the morning, it's not park. I literally roll off of the bed, sometimes onto the floor. Hopefully I can get my feet there before I land on the ground. But I say, God, thank you for a great night's sleep. You are so good to me. Would you please be with Trisha, be with the kids, and I'll be in park as soon as I get 2 or 3 cups of coffee in the body. Maybe for you, your time of park is early in the morning. Maybe it's in the afternoon. Maybe it's at night. But there needs to be a time where we're moving throughout the day, prayer without ceasing, Scripture says. And then a time like Jesus showed us, get to the desolate place and pray. Theologically, when we pray, some people, when I hear you pray, I'm like, man, God loves your prayers. But no, when we're speaking to God, we're speaking to God the Father in heaven on his throne that is not moving, it is not shaking. And the reason the book of Hebrews tells us that we get to approach that throne is the name of Jesus Christ. It's the mighty name. It's not my ability. It's not my things I've done. It's not my thinking. It's not my rightness. It's because Jesus. And the reason that I can walk up and talk to God the Father in the name of Jesus is because of the power of the Holy Spirit. And we don't need to get caught up in like, oops, did I pray right? I prayed wrong. Like, it's the biblical framework. We pray to the Father in the name of the Son by the power of the Holy Spirit. Look in John chapter 16. Jesus tells them, "Now, until now, you've asked nothing in my name." You see, we have the name of Jesus that ask and you will receive that your joy may be full. We're not walking into a stingy God like, sir, please, could I have some more, please? Like some kind of porridge line. But yet we have a God who gives and blesses richly. And this is important. The name of Jesus is your authority and your access to the Heavenly Father. You have no authority in and of yourself. You don't get to walk up in the presence of God because, I gave some money at church. I served one of the Eagle Lake Day Camp was here. I went to Africa on a mission trip. None of that matters. The only reason you get, it's awesome if you guys do that, by the way. But that's not what gets you into the presence of God. It's merely the name of Jesus. When you come into a relationship with God the Father, you are accepting the finished work of Jesus. So it's the name of Jesus. It's His name what gets you in the door. But once Jesus has provided you access to the Father, He then gives you the Holy Spirit. Look with me in Romans chapter 8. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. For we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. So when you're sitting there, you're like, I don't even know what to say, God. I'm here, I'm broken, it's all falling apart. You can just say this, Jesus. 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 It might seem simple, but it's the most powerful. Because the name of Jesus is going to excite the Holy Spirit to take over for you and be the one that's praying. In conversations with God, it's to the Father, as Jesus taught us to pray. It's powerful. There's one place on my drive home. I live literally a mile from this place. But there's one place that a church member has an issue going on. And every single day as I drive by one, two, three times by that space, every single day I'm just in drive. The car's physically in drive. My brain is in drive. My prayer life's in drive. And I'm like, God, would you be with that family? Would you provide for what they need? Would you take care of this issue? And I'm just praying. When I walk into a tense meeting and I'm about to have one of those dialogues that none of us wants to have, I just say to God, God, you told me in your word that if I lack wisdom, what I'm supposed to do right now, I can ask you, and you are faithful and just to give me the wisdom I need. It'd be a great time right now for the Holy Spirit to tell me what I need to do. So if you and I are ever talking, and it appears like I have checked out, I do have ADD, but sometimes, what I am doing is I'm talking to God and doing my best to listen to you because I have no idea. I just want to guard the words that are about to come out of my mouth. And I'm just saying, God, would you guide me? It just becomes a normal part of life. Sometimes I have a hard time sleeping. I'll wake up 2, 3, 4 in the middle of the night, and I'll just start talking to God. And a lot of times when I do something stupid and rash and impatient, and the Holy Spirit will be right there in my life just going, what? And then I just realized, wow, I really blew that one. And in that moment, I can stop and I can have a drive-by conversation with God that's full of grace and mercy towards me. And when I experience the grace and mercy that God gives me, I'm able to then show the grace and mercy to other people. Here's the truth. You need conversational in-drive prayer with God. But you also need devotional prayer where you put it in park. You need park and drive, all on and stop. Drive is conversation. Devotional is stop. Devotional time needs to involve the Word of God, where you listen and let God speak to you. Have you ever talked to someone, spoken with somebody, that just won't stop talking? How enjoyable is that conversation? Look at your prayer life in reflection to the way you talk with God. Do you ever just stop talking and let Him speak? Do you know how much less worry, less anxiety, less struggle you'd have if you would have some time of park and devotions where God could remind you, I protect you. Look over Malachi. God would tell somebody today, I will rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil. This is talking about locusts and harvest. But
for somebody today, it's really important for you in your prayer life to stop and listen to what the Word of God says over you. I got this. Stop worrying. In that culture, the devourer would come and take away what they thought, and they're screaming to God, I need your protection. Peter says it this way, your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. And in prayer, if we let God speak to us, we're reminded we actually have an adversary, and that's why life is going crazy right now. If God is moving in your life this week, I promise you, you don't want to hear this. I promise you, you're going to run into difficult times. Because as you fight through that, the Holy Spirit is on your side in the name of Jesus to bring God glory. But there's an enemy, an adversary, that's prowling around you. If we spend time in our park time, our devotion time, where we stop before God, He's going to remind us truth of why life is crazy. So if you knew what Jesus knew, then you would pray like Jesus prayed. You would know that you cannot outgrow God, so you would spend time praying to a heavenly Father that resides in heaven. We would spend time fully present with an engaged heart with God. But the third one, write this down. Ours is a bigger family. Ours is a bigger family. If you knew what Jesus knew when He was praying, you were watching Him going, I want to know how to pray like that. You would know that ours is a bigger family. Same four words. We already talked about heaven and we already talked about Father, but now focus on this concept of our. For some of you, you walk into the room and you don't have family. You don't have an earthly father and or earthly mother that maybe even are around anymore. Maybe they left you. Maybe they did dishonest things with you. I don't know, but you've never experienced. What does it mean to be part of a family? And Jesus is telling you, you are part of the heavenly family. You're part of my family. Do you know in the Lord's Prayer, there is no personal pronouns. There's no me, my, I. It's all us and our. It's all communal and it's noteworthy and at least means this. We have to have a bigger picture of what prayer looks like in our family. You see, when you get restored to God through Jesus, He becomes your Father and we all become one big, happy family. You know what every family has? Weird Uncle Ned. Your family have that? You might be him if you don't think you can't find someone in your family. We got plenty of them around here. We got weirdos. We got strangers. But we're family. We love each other. And you're part of the biggest family. Stop for a moment and think about this. On planet Earth here in 24 hours, there will literally be millions upon millions of millions of brothers and sisters in Jesus that are part of our family. And it widens your view of life and it should affect the way we pray. Have you noticed that we're normalizing prayer as conversation between each other? And as we normalize conversation with each other, we both talk to our Father. And we get to pray together. And one of the Jesus jukes, or like the Christian things that we do, will come up to me like, hey, pray for me. And then I'm like, cool, I'll pray for you. And we both leave the room. Could we change that in our church? Would that be okay? When somebody walks up to you and says, could you pray for me? Will you actually pray for them? Like right there. Like don't walk away and be like, okay, got you. But would you stop? Would you help me? Let's just change the culture. That is just the cultural way we act together in this place, in our house. Let's pray more together. I always feel awkward when people are walking through like, pray for me. And I'm like, do you want me to pray now or are we praying later? Like, what is the prayer request? So I'll just say, hey, can I pray for you right now? And if you are extroverted, man, this is super easy. And if you're introverted, you're like, there is no way I'm doing this. It might take you 15 seconds. And then you can go hide in the closet. It's fine. Someone walks up to you, I'm going through a tough season. Let's just go, how can I pray? And let's pray. I'm going to ask the Father for you right now. I'm not saying do this at work or at school on the street corner, but I am saying that when we're here in this house, let's just be people that pray. And some of you might say, well, I don't know what the right words are. Don't worry about it. Your words aren't powerful. God's word is where the power comes from. And it's because of God's word, He's promised us that prayer will be powerful. So don't worry about it. I get it. You guys might think, like, well, you stand in front of people and talk all the time. I do.
But sometimes I get invited to some very awkward situations because I'm a professional Christian. And they're like, wow, you must be really good at praying. I have written prayers out before and taken them to prayer places. I have been in the Senate of the United States, and people are like, would you please pray? I'm like, I am not ready for ad hoc prayer right now, but do my best. And sometimes I'll even get this at the end of a prayer. There will be a Thanksgiving, and someone will be like, oh, Brent, you're a pastor, would you pray? Sure, I'll pray. And at the end of the prayer, they'll say something like this. That prayer, oh, it was so good. I'm like, what does that even mean? There's no, like, perfect prayer. There's no beautiful prayer. Can you imagine God in heaven like, oh, Gabriel, come on over here. Did you hear that prayer? It was amazing. I'm answering this one because did you see, he just had all the structure. It was all perfect. It was so good. Do you realize how absurd that is? God's like, angels, standing ovation. Let's go. Put that one on What's Happening in PV on Facebook, right? Like, what? Prayer's all about the heart. Ours is a bigger family, and I need you to pray. I need us to pray. And I need to set aside this perfect prayer thing that we have in our head. I need to set those things aside. A heart that is sincerely engaged is going to just talk to God, talk to Dad. Yes, I'll pray for you this week, but I'm also going to pray for you right now. I want the empathy in our church to go high. Look at James. I love James because he's one of the most powerful statements that Jesus is who he claimed to be because he grew up with him. It got to a place where he said, that is the Messiah. He's teaching us, therefore, confess your sins to one another. Pray for one another right now that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is great power as it is working. I speak to people in prayer. Do you see what could possibly happen if we would be known by the way we pray? Because I believe fervently if we knew what Jesus knew, we would pray like Jesus prayed. Jesus knew that we can never outgrow God. Jesus knew it's a matter of the heart. He knew that our family has a father who's listening. And write this last one down. Fourth thing Jesus teaches. God shapes life through prayer. God shapes your life. He shapes my life. He shapes our lives. He shapes our communities. He shapes our marriages. He shapes our families. He shapes our parenting. He shapes our children through prayer. Do you know what Jesus said right before our Father in heaven? Pray then like this. Not if you pray. Not if you have time to pray. Not if you're concerned about prayer or thought about prayer. Not if it comes to mind. Pray then like this. Be people that pray. Because when we pray, prayer changes things. Prayer is something that tilts the heart of heaven. Jesus knew that our lives are shaped by the way we pray. When I spend time in prayer, it shapes me. When I spend time in prayer, it shapes us. It shapes the world around us. God has made it clear that everything in life is not predetermined. There are things in life that are predetermined. Jesus is the Messiah. Jesus came from heaven. He died on a cross that you might have life. He rose from the dead, defeating death once and for all, that whoever would believe would have life and have it everlasting. Jesus stepped into earth's life history line, and he stepped out of heaven, and there's nothing that Satan or any human can ever do to thwart that Jesus came and that he'll come again. There's nothing that humanity could ever do, not a thing that could be done on earth or in hell that would change the fact that Jesus one day will come back for you and for me. You can read that in Matthew, 2 Thessalonians, the book of Revelation, Daniel. All of that is predetermined. But you know there are things in life that are clearly not predetermined. We can literally affect the outcome of life in prayer. I want to encourage you to join us in prayer because it shapes life. It will shape you. It will shape us. It will shape the world around us. And I'm not telling you God's some cosmic genie that you just wing and he does what you want. Because we have a messed up view of prayer. Sometimes God's going to say, yes, exactly, I answer that prayer. Other times, that's not my plan. And you're going to need to trust me. Because what gets cultivated in prayer is trust. When we live a life trust in a whole new way. Prayer communicates to God, I trust you. And if God is not adjusting my will that I think is right, then God adjusts me to your will so I know what is right. Paul writes to the church in Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities. All things were created through him, for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. That's who we are praying to. That's who God is. And you can see in there, he's powerful, he's loving, he's knowing. Which means we have a God is able. These are really important words. Write them down. Able, willing, and wise. God is able, willing, and wise. And Jesus knew this. What he knew that caused him to pray the way he prayed is God is able, willing, and wise. Because if he's not one of those three things, if God is not able, not willing, not wise, then stop wasting your time praying. Why in the world would you pray to a God who is not wise? If God is able and he's willing, but he's dumb as a log, why would you pray to him? That's wasting your time, his time. Because if God's not wise, that version of God is going to give you every answer yes. And I am so thankful that my prayers throughout my life sometimes are, heck no. No way am I doing that for you, Brett. I only imagine the dumb stuff I said from like age 18 to 24 specifically. There were some dumb requests. But God is faithful. I can trust. Because he is wise. Some of us have friends like that. They're not wise. They're able and willing, and they'll take you to do dumb stuff. Maybe don't hang out with them. But God is willing and able, but unwise, don't pray. Maybe God is wise and able, but he's unwilling. You should stop praying to a God who's not willing to answer your prayers. Because if he's not willing, you shouldn't pray. You're just beating your head against the wall and not changing anything. But Jesus knows that our God is willing. So maybe there's a God that's wise and willing but unable. Don't pray to him because he's powerless. He can't do anything anyway. That's a great idea. I'm so glad you brought that one to me. Sorry, don't have any way to help you. Why would you pray to a God who doesn't have the power to do anything? But Jesus knew. God is able, and he's willing, and he's wise. So if we knew what Jesus knew, we would pray the way Jesus prayed. Because our God is able. I don't know what you're up against right now. I don't know what mountain is up against you. I don't know what obstacles are there. I don't know what you've been told this week. I don't know what you were told last week. I don't know what the struggle you went through this week. But our God is able to do abundantly more than we can ask, hope, or even dream. And our God is not only able, but he's willing. Just think of Psalm 121. Where's my help coming from? My help comes from the Lord. I look to the hills. And I know he's there. He doesn't slumber. He doesn't take a break. He's not on a vacation. And probably the hardest one for an American to accept is our Heavenly Father who's in heaven, who has a heart-engaged relationship with you. So maybe, just maybe, in your prayer right now, God's not answering your prayer. Because it's just not wise. So, Pastor, I understand that. Take it to God. He's able, willing, and wise. We're going to wrap up today. Would you all stand up? What I'd like to do is just pray a prayer together. You may know it. We're not a trespasses place. We're a debtor place, by the way. Just showing you clarity on that one. But let's pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil.